I entered the profession against my will and I said it is a parasitic profession and all that. But you know, the legend of the profession is something which is fascinating. You know, you hear of great trials, great cross-examination, great lawyers. You know, it's a dream. It's your dream to fight for liberty. It's such a fascinating, very romantic subject. But then I never thought that my boon will be granted with such plenty.
Welcome to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice and Human Rights. It is now a decade since Kannabiran passed on. He was a man, take him all in all. I shall not look upon his like again. That was Hamlet. Kannabiran was a self-taught and self-made man. In a profession where godfathers and family and class meant everything, he rose from humble beginnings to legendary heights through sheer dedication and hard work. A prolific reader, he devoured every piece of literature that came his way as he struggled through school, college, and practice. It was precisely that reading which expanded his mind. What forged him into a legend was a sensitive and brilliant defense of political dissidents and revolutionaries who were hunted down by the state during the emergency. He converted the courtroom into a literary convention, often asking his clients to recite poetry or explain the philosophy for which they were charged to the judge. He prided himself on his radical interpretation of the law, often educating the judges before whom he appeared to interpret the spirit and intent of the Constitution. He was admired and loved for his fearless defense of causes, coupled with a deep tenderness for his poorer clients, which made him a much loved figure in Andhra Pradesh. He inspired many young lawyers searching for some meaning and radical dimensions in the practice of law. As president of the Andhra Pradesh Civil Liberties Committee and the People's Union of Civil Liberties, he was critical to expanding these movements to powerful institutions of human rights defense. He was involved in human rights work across the country, which was idolized and adored, particularly in his home state, Andhra Pradesh, by the poor and disempowered and often resented by rich and powerful people unless they had a case or a cause they needed him to fight. It is now a decade since his death. And given the state of human rights today, his presence is sorely missed. This is an effort to preserve his heritage for the bright young lawyers who are emerging today, a generation that he sincerely believed would restore decency, dignity, and justice to our country. Thank you.
The family of K.G. Kannabiran welcomes you to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice, and Human Rights. 10 years after his death, we remember his spirit, his resistance, and his constitutional insurgencies in courts and through courts and tribunals, in defense of dissent, personal liberty, associational freedoms, and justice, speaking truth to power, calling for judicial accountability and state accountability, especially in the matter of repressive laws, custodial violence, and extrajudicial murders, encounter killings, calling out entrenched practices of discrimination and structural violence, and setting out the basic structures of constitutional rule. We bring together a few of the lawyers and judges who knew him personally and worked with him on cases, campaigns, and tribunals to remember their collaborations with him and reflect on future pathways of this important slice of the history of lawyering for human rights and civil liberties, rooted in the Indian experience. K.G. Kannabiran lived and worked in Andhra Pradesh, in Hyderabad. He traveled across the country, appearing in courts of trial and high courts and in people's tribunals and fact-finding missions. from Kashmir, Assam and Manipur to Tamil Nadu, Chhattisgarh to Gujarat to Punjab, Karnataka and beyond. Within Andhra, every nook and corner, every forest and town bear his footprints. Practically every court in every jurisdiction in the state bears his imprint. Every university, meeting hall, meeting ground has heard him speak untiringly on the meanings of the rule of law and the constitution. No place was out of bounds in his quest for justice. We hope to remember him through the futures of his work and through the work of those who carry it forward in so many different ways. In this specific segment of lectures, we bring together the voices of those who shared his calling. Justice K. Chandru started practicing in the Madras High Court in 1976. He joined the Rao and Reddy law firm under Barrister V.G. Rao, a London-educated leftist and a famous trade unionist in Chennai. He wrote extensively about the irregularities committed by Supreme Court Judge Ramaswamy during his term as the Chief Justice of Chandigarh High Court and spearheaded a movement for Ramaswamy's impeachment along with senior advocate Indira Jaisingh. Justice Chandru was elevated as Madras High Court judge on July 31, 2006 and became a permanent judge in 2009. On an average, he delivered 1,500 judgments every month. He ruled that public meetings are a fundamental right. There is no bar on women officiating as priests in a case in Madurai district and passed orders to clear the streets of hoardings. In a dispute over exclusive rights to publish E.V.R. Periyar's work, Justice Chandru ruled that Periyar's writings should be freely available to all. Among his landmark judgments is the one where he dismissed the petition by BPCL that a strike by Petroleum Employees Union was illegal. Known for his integrity and commitment as a judge, Justice Chandru is a prolific bilingual writer on questions of law, constitution, judicial accountability and justice, writing in Tamil and English.
You know, there is no distinction between a friend and a comrade when it comes to Kannabiran, because more often some of us call him comrade, some of them call him Kanna. We call him as KGK. So it all depends on how you relate to him. What is very important is that when somebody calls him Kanna, it's also the name of Krishna, Lord Krishna. In also in Tamil, in a colloquial sense, it's also called darling. A very surprising thing about Kannabiran is that lawyers were 4 decades younger to him. We'll call him as Kanna, and he never mind. So the first lesson that we learned from KGK, I refuse to call him anything else. Sometimes when I call him sir, he used to take offense for using the word sir. Then we used to change it to KGK because initials mean more respect. And then one thing very important that myself and Kannabiran, though known to each other for at least for 4 decades, but we never had occasion to appear together in any matter. Though we worked parallelly in many areas, we have come too close in some areas. We have also worked together in some areas, but never appeared in court. And the relationship between me and Kannabiran was a very, very slow growth. In the sense, since there was no professionally not connected, because he worked in a different area and different high court, I worked in a different area and different high court. I was a labor man and he was mostly advising management. And when he comes to Chennai, there was an opportunity to meet him. What really linked me with Kannabiran is that his activities are relating to civil liberty areas. In fact, it is around the emergency time. There were opportunities, though the media was completely censored and the communication were very risky and the police control over the activities of people who opposed emergency in 1975 was little oppressive. That was the time I think we both were coming to know each other. One reason was in Tamil Nadu, the first phase of emergency in 1975, the DMK party was in power and it opposed emergency also. They were opposed to Indira Gandhi. And many of the activities, including on the one side RSS and the other side left groups, are also functioning in Tamil Nadu. And Tamil Nadu became a little more safer than other states. And that's continued till January 1976. So there were attempts to form some kind of civil liberty groups all over. And some other initial efforts to form civil liberty groups in Tamil Nadu took place. It was mostly a rightist affair because they were having Citizens for Democracy, and the people like some of the retired judges were also a part of that. But it did not have any clear platform. But it also gave the necessity to form a civil liberty group, cutting across all political differences, and also the need to have an institutionalized form of civil liberty was felt at that time. And that was a time when I read in the papers that Kanabiran filed a case challenging the promulgation of civil liberty. Normally, as a trained lawyer, we always think of a forum. And when it comes to higher constitutional issues, we always think of High Court, and then thereafter Supreme Court, and then we used to think what kind of results it may produce, whether it will be counterproductive or productive. And then this is a case where we found very interestingly, he not only challenged an illegal detention of a civil liberty leader in Andhra Pradesh, he also challenged the emergency. Whether it's possible or not, that's a different issue. Because day in and day out, we found in the courts, the judges are also were feeling little hesitant to entertain matters which have some political bearing. Though in some matters relating to habeas corpus, they used to issue notice, and all that stopped when the cases were transferred to the Supreme Court at the instance of the central government. Every habeas corpus, every petition relating to emergency were transferred to Delhi. So the initiative of people working in various states almost came to a standstill because of this attempt. And finally, you know what came out, the ADM, the infamous ADM Jabalpur case, where the court refused to issue habeas corpus on the ground. Fundamental rights were suspended. It was very setback. And therefore, all the more need to start campaign on a bigger level. This is one area which became important for people to come closer. But then how much closer? See, there was after emergency, during emergency, you know, the Naxalite groups, the CPIML groups were all banned under the Maintenance of Internal Security Act. And they were not, they were also very much disintegrated, and they were trying to come together and trying to work in areas which are not so far open to work by other groups. Now, surprisingly, of all places, after Karunanidhi's dismissal from power, and during the short period where the governor rule was in Tamil Nadu, the bureaucracy got strengthened, and people tried to bring in bureaucratic officers like IPS officers, IAS officers. They were really running the rules, and it became advisor government. Advisors were giving advice to the governor, who mostly were acting according to the dictates of the central government, till the parliamentary elections were held. After the parliamentary election, DMK got split, and MGR came to power, and it became worse situation where it is the officers who were deciding. And somehow there was a coordinated effort between the Andhra Pradesh officers and Tamil Nadu officers, where they were trying to suppress, not by links, torture and oppression, and illegal arrest and detention. Several things took place, and the areas which are bordering Andhra and Tamil Nadu became a crucial area where there was virtual manhunt for politically radical elements. And this is happening in areas which are not very much earlier known to be very political. And the theory that was spread here was that the Naxalite from Andhra Pradesh were infiltrated. So that is not true. But these are all mostly areas which are not very well developed. And these kind of protests are bound to happen, and some of the youths were really taken seriously the task of mobilizing the poor peasants and the marginalized labor. And when this happened in districts like Velu, which is closer to Chittur, and district places like Tirupattur, which is also bordering Andhra Pradesh, the question of some local lawyers like Comrade Bhakta Chalam, who is a lawyer from Tirupattur, were sending information that police authorities are increasing, and that the Velu range under which this area is coming was at the time having a DIG, Devaram, the notorious trigger happy cop. And silently, people were incarcerated and sometimes killed also. Now, when these reports came, the question of first time sending a fact finding mission, which all started in Tamil Nadu for the first time in 1977. Previously, there used to be very small level, but was organized attempt was there to send a fact finding team. Till then, we were not very aware the role an NGO can play in these matters. And this fact finding team, which comprised of lawyers, retired judges, Tarkode was there, and of course Kannabiran was there, and there are some college lecturers, and some journalists were there. All of them, when they went to Tirupattur, normally as students of constitutional law, we know that anywhere, any place we can go. Article 19 gives guarantee to go anywhere we want, but that is not in practice, it's never done like that. And when this team went to Tirupattur and stayed in a lodge and gathering information, they were all attacked by, not by any people, but then they were trying to say that they are all people were attacking them. People were fed up with the Naxalite activities. It's all spread by the police. And we knew by the appearance that these people have a very close haircut and then wearing the half trousers, which are all police uniform. And then they entered the lodge and threw out all the baggage, everything. It was very shocking for the first time that the citizens of India can't even know what's happening around them. Tirupattur is 200 kilometers from Chennai, 180 kilometers. And then we can't find out what's happening there. And when this came, this really strengthened, because Kannabiran and Tarkunde were all known by then to be the champions of civil liberty. And then Kannabiran's visit became more frequent to Chennai. Not that he had a brief to appear, he used to come and he used to meet all of us in the High Court campus. And very surprisingly, there are many young lawyers who were very attracted to speak to him and talk to him to know more about these things. And some of us who have entered the practice at that time were also interested in knowing, though our work was much higher, much more hard work, but then we also were interested to know what's happening and how far we can involve ourselves. And then it used to be talk from morning to evening. We used to sit at the canteen, sit in the bar room, sit outside the court hall, and then it will continue. And never once I saw Kannabiran tired of speaking to people individually in groups, and most of them did not have any age communication gap between him and the young lawyers. And he had a very team of one circle of young lawyers who was always surrounded him. And he used to tell us that how to take up these cases. And these cases cannot be left to never taken by the normal criminal side lawyers. In fact, myself, as far as I am concerned, I was not in the criminal side at all. I was on the labor side. But these are the issues which make us to look into the criminal side and also once in a while appear in criminal side for these matters. And slowly we learned our criminal law through these matters, because there was never an opportunity. We were never intended to become a criminal side lawyer. And then no criminal side lawyer will be taking up such cases. In fact, when Bhaktavachalam was arrested, and simply there was nobody to appear even to move a bail. He was a lawyer who was also appearing in the High Court. And then these are the issues which brought more of us. And then we also felt that we can't leave the Bar Association to the status quo element. We should also intervene and raise up these issues in the bar meetings. And they were successful because I became office bearer in the High Court Advocate Association and I became a member of the Bar Council. These are the areas which really were able to bring in issues which will affect. Hitherto, they were discussing more about the professional interests and then how lawyers can be benefited by the professional children, but never an issue concerning civil liberty. And we all learned all these things because first time KGK told us that don't think of higher courts. Start teaching the lower courts the basic rudimentary things about constitution. Criminal courts are not only IPC and CRPC. You should also take the constitution to the trial courts. And then when some of the issues relating to Naxalite prisoners were brought to the court, we realized that how much the austerity that we face. Not that we are preaching left extremism. We are only asking for what is there in the constitution, what is there in the criminal procedure code. But then we could see a hostile court and a hostile government. And then which also brought in determination to us in the sense that the institution is not value-free. It is also loaded and our job is more difficult. So from that time when Kanabiran's visit used to be more often, we were learning more things about Andhra Pradesh, more particularly the police atrocities against ordinary people and the torture and the encounter death and things like that. And then we learned the first lesson that the civil liberty issues has to be raised in trial courts and not in the High Court and the Supreme Court. When the terrorist disruptive activities enacted in 1987, there were not many arrests in Tamil Nadu, but we used to read that in other states it was widely used. In Tamil Nadu also it was used in a very selective fashion. And then the word terrorism, which is a prefix to the law, which can also put off people. Suppose no lawyers are available for appearing in Tara matters, okay. Then who will appear? The lawyers like us who never had much criminal practice, we are forced to appear, all right. And what about the judges? As soon as the case is called, the judge's reaction we can see, and then more often it is very condescending, making it appear, they are asking the question, why you are involved in this matter? Or anybody who appears in this matter are out by themselves are supporters of terrorism. So the first smoke screen that even for lawyers who are otherwise well known, the first stigma of appearing in these civil liberty matters was a main lesson. So we used to ask Kanabiran, how do you face these issues in Andhra courts? He used to tell us that when terrorist laws or any law for that matter, black laws come, don't think that the judges of higher judiciary will be very sympathetic to you, because their thought process and the thought process of the lawmakers will be on the same wavelength. And it is difficult to push these issues to them. And therefore, you should start a clean slate. When I say clean slate, I mean a trial judge who is amenable to listen to you, who is amenable to see the law, who is amenable to read the constitution, who is amenable to see reason, start working there. And then you may not get immediately resolved because there will be pressure. But one day you will realize at least a substantial section of the subordinate judiciary will be well aware and you may get relief, which may be marginal, but then that is more than enough for people who are fighting for larger political issues. And then he used to say, suppose you challenge a terrorist act in the High Court, it may be dismissed in half an hour time. Go to Supreme Court, SLP dismissed, 3 minute time. But you start arguing these cases before a trial court, saying that there is no terrorist offense. He will give you 2 days time. He will give you 3 days time to argue. Sometimes you may succeed, but then your state may go on appeal. But I'll keep you legitimately established in a taluk court that these are all false cases. There is no terrorism at all. So this is something which we've learned from KGK, that the fight for the basic civil right has to start from the first available trial court and not go to the top court. And it is not always top court. Are very sympathetic. We know what happened, and finally the Terrorist Act was upheld by the Supreme Court. On the legislative entry, they said it's a reserved list. On the question of confession, they said, no, no, it's only the superintendent of police who records confession. In fact, Justice Ramaswamy's dissenting opinion that the superintendent of police may not be a value-free man because in his district, he may want to put down crimes and want to show that he is able to be a real super cop. And therefore, he may record confession, not in accordance with law, to suit the convenience of the state. This we saw in every CADA trial, where there is a confession statement was brought in, it was not voluntary. There are people who suffered the incarceration because of the manipulation by the investigation agency, by the state connivance of putting down a political opponent. And this is something which we are able to. And thereafter, Kanabiran used to be invited to some of these cases, but I had the opportunity of seeing them in court. But we also had our own load of appearing in those matters, which slowly made us evolve that what is required is not the political affiliation or political faith of individual. It is a larger state machinery which should be fair in its dealing to the common people, and the courts are there to enforce such rights which are guaranteed. Even to get the guaranteed right, that we have to struggle, and it is not an easy job. This is one thing. Second lesson we learned was that who is an ideal lawyer? This always intrigues us, because in 1925, when the first time the Bar Council formed, the permission to enroll and to regulate the profession was in the hands of the judges. And the British judges had their own idea to keep the bar down and keep them always submissive. It was not an independent profession. But what was important was, coupled with the fact that Gandhi's non-cooperation, the cream of the or the elite of the bar, which went with the Gandhi, and politically, they went away from the profession. It is a second number twos which took over. It may be the nephews and niece and sons and daughters of the existing lawyers, or it may be the partners. But then the profession went through from a political angle to a very purely professional angle. That the idea was to be top in the profession. How to be a top in the profession? Then what kind of money that you make? So if you see the biographies of most of the old lawyers, you will see they say that he had a lucrative practice. What is a lucrative practice? That he made tons of money. Or sometimes they used to say he's a chip of the old block, which means his father, his uncle was a lawyer. For others, there is no entry at all. For people who come from the backward class, people who come from scheduled caste, people who are women, they have no place at all in this profession. And the true success indicator is that you had a lucrative practice and you come from a family of scion of lawyers or a family of lawyers and judges. And therefore it became something like a mercenary team. So if you see the first Bar Council rules, it says that a lawyer shall not stipulate a fee less than commensurate with his standing. Then a lawyer shall not foment litigation. So these are two things which really works against people who are fighting for the common good. Suppose a worker comes, a poor or he can't afford, I can appear free. My standing in the profession may be different. And it never provided for any public interest litigation or community interest litigation or telling the people. Even after the, we were all working in the legal aid in the initial days when there was no official legal aid. When the official legal aid came also, we were part of the legal aid. Now we had a program where we had a legal awareness. Now if you see the Marcondes rules, there is no place for any legal awareness. You are not supposed to foment litigation. And this is something which, therefore, when you see the tons of pages which have been published, praising lawyers, retired judges, you will always see them. These are the two indicators that we had a very good practice. We had made a lot of money. So this is something which is set up as the true indicator of a true personality. Now this is something which we were all troubled. When I became a Bar Council member, I was fighting these rules should be changed in tune with the present trend where poor people are coming to court. The question of charging fee and all that is not a matter of Bar Council should be concerned. But then all of us who are inspired by Kannabiran used to discuss who is a lawyer, who is an ideal lawyer. And we all knew there are some indicators that a lawyer. I come from a firm where my seniors and the seniors before that were all trained in Britain and inspired by National Movement, they came here and worked for the poor. So we realized a true lawyer is a person who fights fearlessly, unmindful of the consequences, who doesn't mind, call a spade, and then he's not bothered about the fee that he receives. In fact, there used to be an appendix of a small packet pouch stitched in front of the backside of your gown, your professional gown, which is, people used to say in those days, a lawyer should not even look into the fee which is paid to him. It is always put in the pouch. But then that is not the, there's all old stories. Now, today, money is everything. In that atmosphere, if there is a lawyer who's not bothered about money, who's not worried about the judge's anger, who's not worried about the state anger, and he may be a good lawyer. And therefore, if you apply this standard, in fact, once as a judge, I was invited by the Bar Council to address the newly enrolled lawyers. I told them the old theory of having lucrative practice or not fomenting litigation is not anymore a standard. And these standards were all put during colonial days. And 1961, when there is new act came, new rules were framed, it was simply carried through. We should now go back to the days where a lawyer is a fighter. Fighter for a cause, not for his own pecuniary benefit, but for the betterment of the people. It could be a civil liberty, it could be a small employment issue or a small land issue, but nevertheless he's a fighter. Then he fights against whom? He fights against the state, against the oppressive authority. Sometimes he also fights against a judge who stands for a different value. Then what about his future? That is not his journey. Who fights fearlessly, unmindful of the cause, but still for his own client, and then never bother about the fee that he may get. He's a true lawyer. So in 2010, when my Chief Justice asked me to write a chapter in our annual book about the leading lawyers, contrary to the past practice, I put all the lawyers who appear for the people, like Vanamamalai, Bhaktavachalam, K.V. Shankaran, their names are there in the High Court yearbook. Many lawyers, the old lawyers were not very happy, but then I feel that you should have a model in this profession. And KGK was a model. And he was still an inspiring model because he was never bothered about the man. He never bothered about the judge. He never bothered about the cause. And he still appeared. For him, that's the most important. In the second lesson, we learned how to be an ideal lawyer. Of course, we had our own differences. For example, when I became a judge, he didn't like it at all. He was a little put off. He thought I was a loss, and many other clients also thought I'm a loss to their service. But I felt differently because Justice Krishnaiyar told me, when it is offered, you should not say no. And then I felt that in from any place we should work, and then it's not a question of only as a lawyer you can help, and as a judge also you can help. I don't want to use this time to say what I did, but nevertheless, after some time I knew that Kannabiran changed his views, and once he called me from, I was very surprised, he called me and then said, how are you? I hope everything is all right. And then he wrote a letter also saying that I'm doing good work, and then he's getting reports from all his friends, and that was a very great certificate I heard. I thought our past bitterness was over by that gesture of Panambiran. But most important thing I realized was that in Kerala, in Andhra Pradesh, when he was fighting issues relating to civil liberty, in one time I was also invited by Balagopal to join a deputation to meet N.T. Rama Rao, then Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh in Hyderabad. The occasion was that the encounter death should stop. Police should not simply kill people, trigger happy. There must be rule of law. I was also invited, so I went there. And then during the time I met Kanaviran, we had spent a long hours discussing many issues. I was always curious that if you are a civil liberty lawyer and there is a conflict, you are basically a lawyer, and then you are also helping civil liberty issues. Now the civil liberties also takes a political stand. What to do now? If there is a individual violence by private groups, then how to answer others? Because your credibility is also an issue where people ask you, how do you justify this? Now these are all the questions which always intrigues every civil liberty fighter. And Kanaviran always had an answer. He said that basically we are committed to law, and we go to the court only to enforce law. We are not begging them for any charity. And then the question, if it is going to be a state violence against private violence, we are against state violence. Not that we support private violence. That doesn't mean every day you must stand up and say, I don't support private violence. That is not required for our, every time you must have a self-declaration. But then you will always be identified by not only the members of the bar or a judge, but even the state propaganda that makes you, he's a Naxalite lawyer, he's a terrorist lawyer. He always says, ignore this, how long they can have this kind of problem. Your work will show to the world what kind of person is. This is something which is very important, because most of the time you feel depressed. People shy away from you the moment you take one unpopular case. Popularity depends on several other factors, but then you take because of the law, legal defense that you want to put up. So slowly from service, labor, education field lawyer, you switch over to become a criminal lawyer for no reason, because there are no other lawyers who are willing to appear for these POTA cases, prevention of terrorism cases. And Jailalsa was using this left, right, center. Anybody, even some two boys were arrested. I was wondering how boys can be arrested in the POTA cases. Then I realized one boy's name is Prabhakaran, the leader of the LTTE. The other boy's name is Bhagat Singh. Maybe police thought these two are dangerous elements. Then we went to court and we said that they can't be tried under POTA. There is a Juvenile Justice Act. And then we fought and finally succeeded. But what I'm saying is, we also learn in the process of how much state is committed to enforcing its own law, how much judges are willing to take a stand unbiased, or at least true to the oath of office they have taken. Now this is something which you can never learn in other branches. Other branches you may win one civil case, next case you may lose, it becomes 50-50. The theory of probability may work. But when it comes to this kind of cases, where the social hostility that you face, people ask you in the bar room, in the verandas, in front of court building, why, sir, why you go for this kind of case? Maybe we are not being professional, but then people ask you, they are interested in you, they are interested in your welfare, but then it makes you more strengthened in your cause that you have taken a vote that you will defend people and get their rights. And we were able to prove, in fact, we were able to prove to such an extent that all these terrorist laws were used against innocent people, against whom not even a shred of evidence was there. Evidence were fabricated just to justify filing of such cases. And then when we met in an international tribunal in Delhi, and Kanaviran was part of the tribunal, there were people from all over India who were giving evidence. I was one of them who spoke on behalf of the people of Tamil Nadu. Finally, there is a very good work produced. Maybe it is part of the post legislation researcher. But then what really happened was the amount of paperwork that is done, the amount of evidence that has been produced really shook the conscience of many people. The government at some point of time were forced to withdraw. Not that they have withdrawn forever, because there are all these black legislation can come in different forms. We have UPA, where you see in the Bhima Goregaon case, all the people, intellectuals are put inside for no basis. Therefore, this becomes an eternal fight. It is not going to be over one day. And this energy to continue to fight comes from Kanabiran. I have never seen him tired. I have never seen him depressed. I never seen him to say, enough of this. I am no more. I am retiring. He has always said, our job is already well settled. And we are trained lawyers. And we are trained and committed to the fundamental cause of freedom. Whether constitution or no constitution, we fight. And that this is something which is an inspiration for all young people. And then we work. And it is not as if only confined only to Indian people. Our work under the liberty, civil liberty area takes us throughout. It's not as if only in Indian soil, because once you confine yourself to a national territory, then the question of your right is also very very much domesticated, and that should go away. That's why when the latest protests against the citizenship amendment came, it should be an international call. It's not confined to one nation. And it is to be an international human right that we'll have to defend. And it is no longer left to a taluk court or a district affair or a state affair. It is something wide. So in that sense, we had an opportunity of traveling together to Hong Kong for an international seminar. This was supposed to evolve some constitutional framework for the Northern Sri Lanka, which was promised some kind of an autonomy at that time. And then there were people from different parts of the world, and we were there. Krishna was there, George Fernandez was there, and several people were there. And I could see that the mind of Kanabiran, which was very incisive mind, that he first said, which is also agreed by many of them, that we cannot replicate Indian model as a model for others. It should be something different, which they should prefer, and they should work according to their own nation's development, their own movement's strength, and things like that. This is something which actually many people like this approach, because we always think working with Indian constitution means it has got solution for all problems. It does not have. On the other hand, it is also having a negative solution, where the state's autonomy is slowly eroded and central government become all powerful. And then whatever promise, whatever the arrangement made at the time of enactment is all disappeared now. And you have one nation theory, which is now being advocated. So this is something which is, in fact, I knew that KGK wrote an article in Economic and Political Weekly, first time on how the president power was used to bring in every law. Because if you see any legislation in India passed by the parliament, it will say it applies to all over India except Jammu and Kashmir. So some people use ask, even law college also, sir, does it mean that Kashmir doesn't have all these things? The judge also, somebody said, what about Charisin case in Kashmir? And then they have a different penal code. Name is different, but the provisions are the same. But then he wrote how presidential power, the executive power of the president, is misused or used to bring every legislation in India without any discussion to communicate. This is something which no other jurist has ever written. This article is one of the earliest articles. How the autonomy of Kashmir is completely broken and completely getting eroded or aggressed by the Indian establishment. The centrifugal forces at Delhi, how it is able to use its power to bring in everything. Now, this is something which is something we'll have to ponder. How the legal framework could be used to make India as one composite territory where one single party can rule to its own whims and fancies. Now, very shortly, we now see fact, it's more than a year since the special status was cancelled. Now you find even the challenge to that is not being heard by courts. That's something which is a very big lesson for all of us. Therefore, the commitment to the constitution, it can go on speak about Ranganathan. I was only tell two, three personal anecdotes. First was impeachment of Justice Ramaswamy, where we came together to work, and then we had a meeting in Chennai, and that meeting passed a resolution that the charges against Ramaswamy are so serious, we should start an impeachment process. And then I wrote an article in Lawyers Collective. He also wrote. We were part of the Lawyers Collective team. We worked with Indra Jai Singh in that matter. And then, of course, the end was different. But the futility of impeachment, the power under 124-4 or 218 for High Court case, is really, though maybe a political power, there are other forces which will not allow it to take it to the logical end, and how people can rally behind corrupt judges. They don't need any open call to support them. The very power they exercise is enough to rally behind them. Even now we can see in the Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister's letter to Supreme Court Judge, the Chief Justice. Now the kind of support that is being drawn by a sitting judge is very unmeasurable. It's something which is there. And in the Ramaswamy's episode, we were able to see that how every Western interest can rally behind a judge, and removing him is not merely a political exercise. Beyond that, there is some other power that saves them. Another thing is very important is never rely upon the organized bar. So the organized bar always supported the status quo, supported the corrupt judges, supported the corrupt establishment, and never even once the organized bar ever protested against the corrupt judge exit from the judiciary. And therefore, the fight is always left to some like-minded individuals, and that was a big lesson we learned. The other thing was that when the Mandal Commission came and OBC reservations around, there were protests everywhere, whereas Tamil Nadu there was not any protest, because there has been a history of reservation in Tamil Nadu, and we had relatively peaceful atmosphere. But nevertheless, we want to tell the people what it is all about. And then Kannaviran came and addressed, and he addressed that meeting supporting the Mandal. Then myself went to several state capitals and spoke on the need for the OBC reservation. This is one issue. Therefore, whenever any social issue, it's not just me, a lawyer or a social activist, to get yourself involved. Your action is not only bar rooms or court halls. Beyond that, you have a commitment to the people. In that sense, very important. And his articles in the Lawyers Collective are all very illuminating and educative. In fact, it should be republished also if necessary, because some of the articles are really shows an incisive mind working in these areas. That's a very important area where we were able to work together. That's another area where I came very close to Kannaviran. It can go on, increase on the number of episodes we could have. But one important issue, that a man can be dissected into different parts and say this is good, this is bad. But if you see overall, that Kannaviran is a standing monument of how a member, a trained lawyer could be. He was a trained lawyer. He was trained mostly in civil areas. But he could transform into a giant supporting the civil liberties of the entire nation, not just confined to Andhra Pradesh or Telangana. Beyond that, that his mind worked for the people of India, not just 1.3 billion people of this country. And today, when we remember him, we remember him not because he was a good lawyer, not because he was a civil libertarian. He was a good human being. He was a standing monument for the civil liberties issues in India. And he always used to say that when you want to appeared for civil liberty issues, the you will have to face not just attack from the state, but attack from everywhere. It's not as if you will be confined only to attack from the state, from the bar members, from the judges, from your own family also. There may be pressures there saying that when others are not doing anything, why you should get involved? And when the fight becomes very intensive, the your pressure on you also goes increase. How to withstand this pressure? Then you should go to Kannabira. He always used to say, "Chalta hai, just take it lightly. Don't get upset about these things. These are all going to be there. Just ignore them." And this is something, the self-determination, that the determination to fight for certain beliefs which you believe is a correct belief, certain action which you think is a correct action, certain steps you should take which are correct steps, and then you should look for Kannabiran for inspiration. I think we have gained many things from him. Though we are from a state where the civil liberty activities is not proceeded, though I told you in 75 we started that, we still have a very small group and there are a lot of faction ridden, and we also have faction means not just ideological, also personal. Did not grow like Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh had a very big history of having established institutional form of defense at all levels. We are having rudimentary steps taken, but the teachings of Kannabiran is always a shining model for people to work in these areas. And I'm happy that Kalpana asked me to write a small note, which I said, KGK is a magic acronym, and he's still, Kannabiran is a role model for many of us, and I wish that his message is taken to a wider audience. Thank you, Kalpana.